for the people he choose for his task.
That's right.
And then I want to underline that he equips you for the task.
Uh-huh.
But you have to first of all, recognize him.
Yeah.
Because without him, you can do nothing. And so it was for Ezra. He had 2,000 people to move from Babylon to Jerusalem. And this was over 700 and some miles.
Yep.
Now we get tasks in our lives today. And we must confess, we began to worry. We fret. How am I going to do this? The problem is you take that eye out.
Oh, yeah.
You're not going to do it. See, if you're going to do it, it ain't going to get done. That's where your problem starts. You need to say, how are we, don't even say, Lord, we going to do this. Don't even put a question mark, how are we going to do it?
That's it.
Just say, we going to do this.
Yeah.
And that we is God's going to help you with this.
Amen. Yeah.
He always equips you and helps you in your task.
Mm-hmm.
And I say this, and I said this last week. Sometimes we don't always do that, but we'll have to always underline that scripture in all thy ways.
Yeah.
Acknowledge him, uh-huh, first of all.
Yeah.
And he will.
Yes, he will.
He'll get you going. But you first of all, he's God.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll direct your path.
Uh-huh.
And so it was with Ezra as he began his task. One of the things that I noticed about Ezra that when he began his task, when he got down to the river, he realized that there were no Levites. And he sent for some Levites. Isn't that amazing to notice that there's something missing on this task? Sometimes even in our human efforts, God will put in us to realize that I'm gonna orchestrate it, but I'm gonna put the motion in you to bring to your mind that maybe it's something you can do. God can do everything, but we gotta do some things.
Yeah.
We wait for him to do, we just sit back, well, I know he's God. He can do it.
Yeah, they can.
But he needs you to be part of that also.
Yeah.
This is a collective. He's all powerful. He can do it by himself. But you need to be part of that. So when I look at this, and Ezra got down and he sent for these Levites.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that I like about Ezra. He realized that this journey, and I know God is with me, but we're going to demonstrate something here. We're going to fast and pray. We're going to be serious about this journey before we take off. Before we do anything, we're going to do this fasting and praying. And one of the things that I like about this, God is never failing that he said he's going to do. Here's the thing that I think where we get off course. We're looking for the outcome this way. God has already orchestrated that way. And we're looking over this way.
Uh-huh.
And God has already orchestrated you going this way.
Mm-hmm.
And you're looking for the outcome to be another way.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like you want it. It's how he's going to orchestrate it. And so he began to, and look, can you imagine? I can fast. Can you fashion in my mind 2,000 folk having a prayer meeting?
I hear.
Can we get 30?
I hear.
Can you, if we have prayer meeting, you say we're going to have prayer meeting this week. How many are we going to have? Huh? Why not? We're going to have a house full. We're going to have prayer. We're going to come together collectively and pray. That's what makes it effective. Because everybody is with one accord.
Uh-huh.
Everybody has a prayer in their heart.
Yeah.
everybody is sincere about what's to take place. Now, your prayer might be only 3 or 4 words.
Uh-huh.
But everybody, and then you may not pray, but in your heart, in your spirit, you're there mm-hmm. in prayer. And the whole essence of that all together makes a difference. Mm-hmm. So that's why, and you know when you do that, you get God's attention?
Yeah.
And that's what I liked about when they did this and all come good, as our lesson ended last week. Let me just kind of leave that. I want to look at that because that was something that happened at the end of that.
Sure, yeah.
Let me look at it. So we fasted. Look.
Yeah.
And that's connected to Jesse. We didn't just fast.
Yeah.
And besought our Lord. We
yeah.
We beckoned him. We called on him.
Uh-huh.
We besought our Lord for this. This journey.
Mm-hmm.
And he was entreated of us.
Yeah.
What that was, that God honored them
yeah.
and he protected them on their journey.
Yeah.
God heard them.
Yeah.
That's the thing that got this whole thing going. We did our part and he heard us. We sing that song, you know, it has some essence in it. It can touch you. I love the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
He
heard my cry.
He what?
Heard my cry.
And he pitied every wrong. Long as I live,
uh-huh.
long as I
yeah.
live, I'll hasten
yeah.
to his throne. That'll work right there. That'll work right there. But I love the Lord.
Uh-huh.
You've got to have some love for the Lord. He loves you. Let's reciprocate that.
Yeah.
He loves you in spite of you.
Uh-huh.
And says, well, if you have that kind of love,
yeah.
and before you can cry unto him,
yeah.
he's working on your situation. He's already got it fixed up.
Yes.
Sometime he might send you a letter back. I knew you was going to do that. I got it worked out. I was waiting for you to come with me. I was already working on it. I got it all fixed out already. But I was just waiting to hear from you.
Yeah.
I knew your situation before you even called on me. I knew what kind of situation you was in before you even called. I knew you were down. I just wanted to hear from you. And so it was that now that Ezra is taken from this journey and he begins to lead. But now, all of this, because he has a lot to take with him. Not only does he have the people, but he has a lot of money to take with him. A lot of valuables to take with him. And these were for no personal use. These were for the temple. Everything that was there was for the temple. And so, as we look at our lesson, as it starts out, this first part of our lesson is going to talk about doing service in verses 24 through 27. Then I separated 12 of the chief of priests, Sherebiah and Hasabiah, and 10 of them brothers with them. And weighed unto them the silver and the gold, and the vessels, and even the offering of the house of our God, which the king and his counselors and his lords, and all of Israel there presented had offered. I even weighed unto their hands 650 talents of silver, and silver vessels 100 talents, and of gold 100 talents, and also 20 vases of gold, and 1,000 drams of two vessels. And I said unto them, ye are holy unto the Lord. The vessels are holy also, and the silver and the gold are freewill offered unto the Lord God of your fathers. One of the things that I want to look at as we look at this thing of the gift for the temple, our lesson here talks about us giving our all to the Lord. Can I tell you that we need to really be serious about this? Sometimes we act like we don't have time for the Lord.
You're right.
I ain't got time. He can take time away from you.
That's right.
You sure won't have no time.
You're right.
But he wants you to spend some time with him.
Uh-huh.
All of us ought to have a time when we can spend some time with him.
You're right.
And then he wants it. Look. Here's the thing that I think we get hung up on a lot. This is a physical church. This is the church. This is our come where we worship. But we ought to be serious about our coming here.
Uh-huh.
When we come here, this is a place of sacred. This is something that we're coming to worship together. We ought to give our all when we come here, whatever we do. Whatever we do, give it our best. That when we come here, give the best we can.
Yeah.
And here's where the crux comes. We talk about our time. Sometimes we don't give that. But here's the part where it hits. He wants to give you best of your talents.
Uh-huh.
Can I tell you, he's not talking about your skill?
He's
talking about your dinero.
Uh-huh.
Talents is money.
Uh-huh.
Give the best you can. Talents are not all skills, because when you talk about that, sometimes, Sister Moulton, can I say this and I don't mean no harm? Sister Moulton, do you ever remember going to country church? Were you ever part of a country church?
Yeah.
When they give an offering, how much did they normally give? How much an individual normally would give, probably?
You know,
no, I mean just as an offering.
No.
Huh?
So
get what?
The dollar.
That was probably back young.
Yeah.
We moved to 2023.
What they give?
What we gonna probably give?
A dollar.
Wait a minute. We moved from back yonder when Big Mama and them were going to church.
Yeah.
And all that they gave, that dollar. We modernize now. We our finances are better now. So we give. Y'all keep saying that.
$5.
We are in the dollar syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
And we cannot break out of this dollar syndrome.
You remember what Deacon Smith used to say about that dollar?
What did he say?
Deacon Smith said they give a dollar and then they mash it up so you can't take
it. I work with the finance committee in St. John. I look at this and it has to be sometimes fascinating to me to be a congregation full of folk. I tell folks, George Washington come to church every Sunday. George don't miss.
Yes.
He gonna be there.
Yeah. Yeah.
If nothing else gonna come, Brother Hubbard. You know, Sister Nia.
Good morning to everybody.
Good morning.
I have to learn that God blesses me from my offering.
Mm-hmm.
I have learned that.
Mm-hmm.
Not from my time.
You
opened that time. Yeah. So he blesses me off of the offering, but I had to learn that through Bible study and Sunday school.
Uh-huh.
That's where my blessing comes from.
Oh.
not, it's not just your offering in church.
Right.
It's your offering overall where your heart is in regards to a giving.
Exactly.
See, because like you say, you run into a stranger out there sometime.
That's it.
Might be in need.
That's it.
The way you react and respond to that stranger,
that's it.
God is watching.
Sister Brad.
And another thing, I agree with them, like the tithes and offering, but then two people are so stuck in routine and custom, they don't want to change. And they don't have faith in God's word.
You said something there, Sister Bracken, that puts us in a rut. Change.
Mm-hmm.
We don't like change.
Right.
You try to change something, boy, you get all kind of. We don't. Well, we've been doing it this way.
We all forget.
I'm gonna just be honest with you. I would guarantee you within the last 2 years. There's a room in your house that you've changed something in there.
Yeah.
It's been sitting here for the last time, and you just rearranged it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's just something, you just like some change.
Uh-huh.
Why do we don't like to come to change when it comes to God's house? Mm-hmm. We've been doing that with all these years. This is near. But here is this thing that I would like to us to imprint in our mind. God is generous.
Yes, right. Yes, he is.
Right.
God is generous.
Yes.
In all his ways.
That's right.
And we cut him off.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to him.
Uh-huh.
That reminds me, and sometimes, and we look at this, I don't care where your income is or what all like that, mm-hmm. but when you're giving the best of what you can do, God recognizes that. God recognizes that. Well, Sister, you might not be on the $100,000 income. You may be only getting $20,000. But you doing that $20,000, you doing generously all that I can. And God knows that you're doing that. And here's the thing that I don't understand why folk don't get it. But maybe it's just a saying. I think that's what it is. The more you
give.
That ain't never been said. Huh? That ain't no saying. The more you
give.
Y'all believe that.
You ain't gonna get nothing with your hands.
Huh?
You ain't get nothing with clothes feet.
Yeah, this. Get that with the clothes fish. That's all you get with the clothes fish. And here's the this. I want to bring this thing to our attention. When you give this way, it may not come back the same
That's
way.
Right.
That's right.
Say that, man. Say that.
I want y'all to recognize that.
Say that.
You gave from here.
Uh-huh.
But when he gives back, it's going to come another way.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
So the more you give, the more he gives to you.
Uh-huh.
See, God doesn't want us to be without.
That's right.
And he's a good provider.
Yes, uh-huh. He is.
And he said, all I want you to do is be generous. in your time.
Uh-huh.
In your talent.
Uh-huh.
And you have a good life.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was here that Ezra now has his journey and he makes this. But just before the departure for Palestine, Ezra thought it would be best to divide the gold, silver, and the other valuables for the temple so that these could be more easily protected on the journey. He divided them by weight and gave a portion to each of 12 men whom he had selected to be responsible for these valuable things until they should reach Jerusalem. The 12 were representatives of the 12 tribes, thus indicated that the returning exiles recognized the fact that Israelites from the whole of the 12 tribes were being restored as a nation, not Judah and Benjamin. There was still some for that. Here's the thing, and I like this, there was a word that came in there. Those he gave were responsible. Everybody can't handle valuable things.
That's right.
Some folk get tempted.
That's right.
On some things.
That's right.
Some folk can't, you get $15,000-$20,000 and they ain't gonna miss this 50.
I hear you.
But see, myself, I'm scared, Mr. Lawman. You ain't never worried about me.
Well,
I'm scared to mess with the Lord's money, so I won't touch a penny of it. I remember that was he's gone home to be glory that long time ago, brother, he was a member of Rising Star, and he was a treasurer before I came treasurer years ago, and Sister Carter appointed me the treasurer, and Brother Robert Humphrey. Robert Humphrey was so humble about that money, he was scared about that money. And we would count that money, and he would tell me, he said, Brother Brian, everything there? And he, before we leave, we double check it. He wanted to be sure that all that, because he didn't, he said, I don't want to mess with the Lord's money. I don't want to be in trouble with the Lord's money. And I'm the same way. You know, if I find something in the church, it don't belong to me.
I know, that's right.
If it's a dime on the floor,
mm-hmm.
I ain't put it in my pocket.
I hear you.
It ain't mine. Well, yeah, what if it was a $50 bill?
I'm at the ass.
$100. There you go. In all honesty, it did happen in this church.
Yeah.
Someone had lost that. Was it ever claimed?
I don't think so.
It was never claimed.
I remember
30 days.
Sister Synagogue's grandson.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, we gave it, never was claimed. We gave it back to him.
I mean, Eddie was honest about it.
Yeah. He turned it in and we kept it for a certain number of days. Nobody claimed it.
Nobody said they had lost anything?
Somebody had left by paint they'd gone to the temple and had lost the whole temple. Just left it there on the ceiling.
Wow. Yeah.
Oh, I want to try again. Yeah. Oh,
But in this, as they are now making this journey, these 12 that have been divided with this responsibility. That is some kind of money that they were dealing with. The value of the money divided in the 12 parts, 650 talents of silver. One talent was $1,920. 650 talents was $1,248,000. Two silver vessels amounted to 100 talents. Each one of them was $192,000. 100 talents of gold. Each talent was $29,085. That was $2,908,500. Four basins of gold amounted to 1,000 drachma. Drachma was $5.28. So that was $5,280. Two vessels of fine copper, as precious as gold. Each one of them were $264, which amounted to $528. The total amount that they were carrying was $4,354,308 on their journey among 12 responsible people. And I like to underline that responsible, because God had probably, well, with these Levites in time, God knew who he was going to orchestrate Ezra to appoint to take care of this. God knows who to put the responsibility to. They used to tell there was a guy in one of our settings, he said, don't let no broke person take care of your treasure.
That's right.
He said, don't let a broke person be over your treasure. Because when they broke, their temptation to set in too quick. And that was years ago that I knew of a church had a treasure and he pilfered some of their money. I wouldn't touch it. I would be, and they found out about it. This thing of and what I like about this, you know where all this came from? God had touched these kings and counselors when they were there in Babylon.
Yeah.
And they said, go out among you and all the silver and all the gold that you can find and give it to them that they can take that with them.
Yeah.
It's funny, God is a way maker.
Yes, right? Yes.
He knew that they would need something, so he touched the hearts of these kings and these counselors.
Yeah.
And not only did they obey God, they began to worship God.
Yeah.
God can change anything.
Yeah.
These kings probably didn't part, these Israelites, they probably said, I'd be glad we didn't leave out of here and go on home. But God had touched them that said, you know what, be generous when they leave. Mm-hmm. And they touched them. And sometimes our blessings come from unknown ways.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Some way that you would never think would come.
Yeah.
Your blessings come from.
Uh-huh.
A person that you would never think would come from.
Uh-huh.
God touches them and sends them your way.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. The last person, the least that you thought would help you,
yeah,
is your helper.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
But God does that. He can change the heart.
Yeah.
He can change the mind of men.
Yeah.
Whatever he wants to get done, he can do it. And so it was that all of this, they began to do this. What I like about this, listen, when they prayed and fast, they had to pray that there would be no robbers.
Uh-huh.
Because if somebody, you know what they taking to Jerusalem? Mm-hmm. We're going to get out.
That's right.
And the folk that was back in Babylon, you know what they, we're going to get us a party down the line. When they get down about 100 miles, we're we gonna get us a plan together. We gonna get some of that back. You know, people can scheme.
That's right.
When there's some money, cause you, and that's evil. Cause well, money is what the what? The love of money is the
root.
Evil began right there.
Uh-huh.
If they love to have that money, that starts that evil right there. And evil thoughts is evil deeds. And so here it was. And you know what? Here's the other thing that I never really thought about. Not only did he have to protect them from robbers, mm-hmm. but he had to protect them from all the wild animals.
That's right.
This was a place where they were out on the open, there were all kinds of animals out there. So he had to protect them doubly, not only from robbers, but for all the wild animals were there. And so he did that. And so when we look at verse talking about being doing service in verses 24 through 27, look at this. Give it a like in verse 27. It says this demonstrated how fully the people, both Jew and Gentile, gave, listen, without holding anything back.
That's what it said.
You know how sometimes we can.
Yeah.
They just, mm-hmm. whatever, just reaching in, just gave. They didn't try to hold back. Look, what if God operated like we operate? We hold back on him. What if he hold back on us? So, Freeman, would we be in bad shape? Huh? Sometimes that ought to really shake in your shoes.
Mm-hmm.
If God treated us like we treat him,
uh-huh.
if he was that kind of God, but he looks over our faults.
Oh, yeah.
He blesses us not because of, mm-hmm. he blesses us in spite of.
Uh-huh.
See, if he blessed us according to what we really are, our blessing would be sure.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
But in spite of all that we do, all that we say, he blesses us in spite of that.
Amen.
That's the kind of God he is. And so when we look at that and think about that. But Ezra began to look at this, and he had all of these 12 together, and all of this was now ready for the temple. In verse 28, now it talks about this consecrated for the temple. What does consecrated mean?
Set apart.
Set apart. It's now set apart for the temple. Not for any personal use, nothing else. When we think about this, we as a people are set apart. I'll touch on it in a minute. I'll tell you what I'm saying on this. And he said unto them, here it is right here, ye are holy unto the Lord.
Uh-huh.
The vessels are holy also.
Uh-huh.
And the silver uh-huh. and the gold are free will offering unto uh-huh. the Lord God of your Father. He hears what I say. That word holy, what does that mean? What is holy?
I think it means being set apart and consecrated for okay. special purpose.
Okay. He hears I like it because listen, he says, ye are holy.
Mm-hmm.
The vessels are holy.
Mm-hmm.
Let's look at this. It's from an individual to material. Ye are holy.
Mm-hmm.
Holy, moral and ethical, wholesome are perfection.
Right.
Freedom from moral evil.
Right.
That's the individual part of us holy.
Right.
Freedom from moral evil.
Mm-hmm.
That's the holiness.
Okay.
Yeah. I like, didn't God say, God say I'm holy?
Uh-huh.
Be did he say that?
Yeah.
Do we take that? Do we take that in consideration?
We should.
Huh?
We should.
I'm holy. You're part of it, so be ye holy. Wow. That's foolish. It is. The word holy denotes that which sanctified or set apart for divine service.
Yeah.
You understand? For divine service. Set apart. Sanctified. So we look at that when he talked about that evil from the personal, but then these vessels said they are holy too. So that means that they are set apart for divine service.
Yeah.
That's what they were saying. You're holy?
Yeah.
This is holy.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. You cut from evil?
Yeah.
These is all this together is not for spending.
Yes, sir.
This ain't no spending money.
Yeah.
This ain't no this is for divine service.
Yeah.
This is set apart for divine service.
Yeah.
It's a whole lot of money. I don't care. But can't we take something off? It's for divine service only. And so that's what he was demonstrating right there.
Yeah.
And sometimes when we think about this, we need to really listen to God's word.
Uh-huh.
God is not really, how I want to say this, God is not really harsh in his word, but he's, I'm going to use his word. He's stern when he means what he said.
Uh-huh.
He don't want to be taken lightly. When I was growing up in school, you know what I learned, Sister Moten? The sternest teachers I had were the best teachers I had.
That's right. You're right.
I thought they were mean.
You're right.
But they were the best. I didn't understand when I was the first 4 or 5 weeks in there. But by the time I got through with that course, them stern teachers were the best ones I had.
That's right.
Because they were looking out for my benefit. And when they brought it to me, I wasn't digesting it well.
Yeah.
But it was all for my benefit.
That's right.
Sometimes when God speaks to us, we've got to digest it because it's for our benefit.
Uh-huh.
He's looking out for you.
That's right.
God does not want to hurt or harm you. He wants to help you.
Uh-huh.
And you just need to listen to him and yield to what he's saying.
Yeah.
He's not trying to harm you.
Yeah.
He's always looking out for the best for you.
Yeah.
Always. He wants the best for you. And so sometimes we want to get mad at the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
What do we do?
Yeah.
Sometimes we get mad for a moment.
You right?
We pout a little bit.
Uh huh.
But he don't mean us no harm.
No. God's word in this book, in his Bible, for me, is there to keep me from going through what some of them went through in this Bible. Mm-hmm. He don't want them to have to go through. That's why he want me to study it.
Uh huh.
God knows where your every pitfall is.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
He knows where your every down day is.
Yeah.
And he's trying to avoid you from having so many pitfalls.
Uh-huh.
If you will listen to my directions, you can avoid all these pitfalls. But if you want to be hard-headed, look, I know some of us had some children.
Yeah.
All one of them was hard-headed. You could tell them over and over again, they go out and bump their head and didn't learn, and you set them down and you be stern with them and you turn around and get it. When you gonna learn? You have to, boy, they hard-headed.
Uh-huh.
That's what you wanna do. You could do it then, Sister Nick. You could take them to the shed then.
Yeah.
But you can't do it now.
No, I'll put the Lord on that.
That's stronger than that belt.
Yeah.
but sometimes we get that was I'll never forget this and it resonates with me every time when I think about this. That this preacher, his text was, how hard is your head? God is telling you something, how hard is your head? We can get hard-headed. Get our own agenda, what we want to do. God's telling you no, and you're saying, yeah, I'm grown. When you get grown, something happens. I don't know about this grown thing. All of a sudden, folks talking when they grown, about that. Something from the world when it's going to come. When they feed back to you, I'm grown. Back up. Back up. Yeah, yeah. When they tell you they grown, you just leave them alone. Okay. You grown then. But when grown get in trouble, don't come this way then. See, grown get in trouble, then they ain't grown no more.
I hear you.
That's what I'm talking about. What happened to that being grown? And sometimes if we're not careful, we almost want to tell the Lord, I know what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. And he said, no, you don't. You don't. You heading for a downfall, and you think you got it going on. And you find out when you get down into the downfall, I should have listened to what the Lord God was telling me. And so land in verse 29. Verse 29 is a command. This is a command. Verse 29 says, watch ye and keep them until ye weigh them before the chief of the priests and the Levites and the chief of the fathers of Israel at Jerusalem. In the chamber of the house of the Lord. Why did he say, why did he command him to do this? Here's why. They left with a certain amount. They wanted them to go to the priest. When they do it again, it needs to equal what you left with, and when you go back to the priest, it needs to be the same. His things could happen. There could have been some robbers that could have taken this, but there could have been someone who's careless could have lost some of it. So they had to do accountability. You left with this much. Now you need to reweigh this and go for the priest. Everything that you left with, go before him again and be sure it equals. Tally up, as we can say. Everything comes and everything is there. And I want to say this. And so he took the priests and the Levites and weighed of the silver and the gold and the vessels to bring to Jerusalem unto the house of God. Everything was there. I want to say this in our giving. This book talks about this, and let's do the best we can. That's a tough word on us sometimes. Give generously. Sometimes it's tough. Because that's my lunch money. Sometimes it's my lunch money. I got a whole bag of nation, $500. But you know what God, you know when God, when you give it all to him, it comes back?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
It may not be this day. But somewhere down the line, it come tenfold back.
Right.
And then sometimes, as I say, it may not all be monetary. But God is such in the blessing business.
Yeah.
I want to just remind us again, do the best you can. Give your best.
Amen.
God gave his best.
Yes,
he thought enough to send the best. He sent his son.
Uh-huh.
And he says, all I want you to do is give the best you can.
Uh-huh.
And I tell folks, be careful when you say that. Well, God knows my heart. Yeah, God knows you're holding back.
That's right.
You tell the truth. He knows. He know you're holding back.
Yeah.
You better be careful when you tell him. They kind of, well, he knows my heart. Well, holding back on it. There was a person, this person, they could not, and I don't even think today, they cannot relate to him. And they couldn't fashion giving $100 to the church. They couldn't fashion giving that kind of money to the church. Give $100 to the church. They gone from $1, they do the $5. So they thought they were upscale doing $5. I don't know about that, even $105. When you are tight with God, he gonna be tight with you. Don't expect God to do more for you than you do for him.
Amen.
And I think we expect that. We do little for him,
uh-huh,
and we want more from him.
That's right.
God is, and we'll just beg him and ask him and all this, and we ain't doing nothing for him. Sometime, and I'm going to say this, not other, let's review this thing. Sometime we need to give him some of our time.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Let's give him some of our time. This time of worship, it's a sad connotation that God's folk can't come and give him. You know, and here's the thing, I'm going to say this. Since we come back, we don't even do 2 hours.
I hear you. You're right.
And we can't even do an hour and a half.
Uh-huh.
We done condensed it somewhat.
Uh-huh.
And folk can't give. And you got 6 days and 20 hours to do everything you want to do. And all he asks you to do, can you give me some of your time? Can you come and just worship as my people for a little time? And we don't have time. Sad connotation. It's a sad connotation that we can't give him some of our time. And I say this. You laid last night, he said, since you can't give me some of your time, I'll just take time away from you. Since you want all that time, I'll just take it away then. Since you're not putting it to use for me, I'll just take it away. Be generous in whatever you do for the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Time has made a change. For another outstanding job teaching our Sunday school lesson this morning. We're up to our highlights, and we do have 2 classes this morning, so we're going to ask for our youth class to come forward at this time.
Amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Talked about family, and I think it's something that's important for our children to understand, you know, the hierarchy of how, you know, their family is, but also we talked about the family of Jesus.
Mm.
And so she's going to tell you today about Jesus' family, and then she's going to tell you about her family.
Okay? Amen.
So what did we talk about? Who was the first person we talked about?
So, Father God.
We have God the Father, and then who?
Jesus.
And he's the what?
Son.
Okay. And then what is Jesus' earthly parents' name?
Joseph. Mary.
Right. Okay, then what's your name?
Jaquela.
Jaquela. And what's your mother's name?
Renelle.
And your father?
Patrick.
Now, it was funny because when I asked for her father's name, she said, Loki. I said, I think that's his new name. She said, no, because that's what he taught me. But we got confirmation from grandma.
Jemiah.
And your brother.
Jay Sean.
And who's the last person?
Pat.
And who is Pat?
Grin.
Okay. Now, one of the things about, I was asking her about Jesus, you know, to tell me things that she knew about Jesus. And when we got to talking about it, she couldn't remember, you know, his mother and father's name, but she remembered when I said, you know, that he died on the cross. And she talked about how he had nails in his hands. She talked about how there was two men on both sides of him. So even though the kids may not know all the details about the story of Jesus, they pick up on little bits and pieces. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's important that we continuously teach them the same story over and over so that they eventually will get it all. And the same thing for us as adults. Uh-huh. We need to read it over and over and over again so that we can get all the details and we'll understand that Jesus had to come for our sins. And I asked her, I said, do you ever sin? She said, I said, yes. I said, I do, and you do, and everybody else do too. But that's why Jesus came, to save us. Mm-hmm. So thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
I want to thank that young lady for taking a stand. I had gone back and asked Sister Harris if they wanted to have highlights this morning. And you know, it means a lot when a child will stand before and look out there amongst all you people with all these strange faces looking at them. It takes a lot of courage for them to stand up here and have something to say. So we want to commend her for her taking that stand and sharing highlights with us this morning. Now we up to our grown folk. And anyone that would like to share highlights about our lesson this morning. Gifts for the temple.
I thank the Lord.
All right.
I go to my kitchen table
open up my living, that 1 year Bible, and you got it, and I read Proverbs.
Right.
It is something about Proverbs.
Yeah, yeah.
Proverbs teaches you how to live.
Sorry.
Get back where you want to go. The way of it is, you want to go. Proverbs will teach you how to live. You want to go up there, it'll teach you that.
Yeah.
And it'll tell you how to get down here, too. Because a lot of people on this earth do not believe that there's a heaven. It's in the Bible. If it's in the Bible, it's that.
It's all right.
All I want to do, like he said, there will be a judgment day.
Uh-huh.
We all going to be judged.
Yeah.
You just want to, you know, you're going up there, and when you get ready to judge, all you want to do is stay there. You don't want to say, apart from me.
No.
I'm going to be like Sister Rose. I'm just going to start crying. Because I'm trying my best. I'm going to tell the Lord, I'm trying my best to get up there.
Yeah.
And so Sister Rose said, just start crying. John,
yes, ma'am.
All right.
Pastor, to our teacher this morning, it's hard to come behind Sister Mo. But I just wanted the teacher to know that I did learn something.
Amen.
And I learned this morning how God will take ordinary people and have them to do extraordinary.
He will.
That's what I got out
of it. Amen.
That's what he did to Ed and the people. And the people were obedient.
That's the thing.
They had a whole bunch of stuff to do. And they were so obedient to them. And this is what we're going to have to do.
Yeah.
I know all the time maybe I'm not obedient, but then God had the Holy Spirit gets me back in line.
That's all right.
And
I'm right
back into doing what God wanted me to do. But this we are off of the book of Israel. I think this is the last week. I've had a time for 4 weeks with the book of Israel. I wish I could be like him, but he guided those people.
Yeah.
And they just did what they needed to do for the Lord. And then the last thing, teacher, I saw where they brought everything into the temple, and then they went home.
Went home. That's it.
Yeah.
Yep. Amen.
Amen.
We'd like to thank Sister Neal and Sister Moten for those highlights. At this time, we're going to give to us Reverend Shields for our review.
Amen.
Teacher, Sunday school teacher, and our Sunday school superintendent. Sister Neal, it's good to see you.
Amen.
I was really surprised when I walked in and I saw you. God bless you. And to Pastor.
Amen.
This lesson, all of the lessons that we've studied in the Bible, is lessons that will help us to be a better person.
Yep.
Amen.
See, because we live in a world of two dispositions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We were born a sinner, and then we were saved by grace.
Uh-huh.
And so God is really, really good.
Yeah.
I think about when I was here first time at New Light, and then I left and I come back, and one Sunday, they were awarding those that had participated in, I think, Sister, give me the name, Sister. Sister Harris, amen. Sometimes it just don't come out. But anyway, they was awarding those that had participated in so faithfully in the service. And they gave me a plaque, walk by faith.
Is that right?
And I didn't understand what that was. I went home and I talked to the Lord. I said, Lord, tell me what this means, walk by faith. Because I had left here, I had went to 7-8 other different churches, and God brought me back. We're looking for you, Sister Mary. We're looking for you. We need you. We need you, but faith.
Amen.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for. And the evidence of things not seen.
That's it.
All this that we participate in. One day God is going to say, come on, my child.
Yeah.
And he's going to take us back home with him.
Yeah. Amen.
And I'm working for that day.
Yeah.
All right.
God is good.
All the time.
And gifts for the temple. It's good.
Amen.
For the temple. It's not good for us to keep it in our pocket.
That's right.
But everybody's situation is not the same.
That's right.
So that's why it's not good to talk about. When you, what you give, when you give, and how you give.
That's right.
Don't talk about
it.
If you're going to give it,
yes,
give it. If you're not going to give it, then hold it. Everybody can't talk on giving. Because it's a one-sided conversation. And I see Pastor looking at me, and I'm finna sit down. Any questions? At this time, I'm going to extend an invitation to Christian discipleship. There might be one here this morning. I see my friend back there. God bless you.
Amen.
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 There might be one here. Let me repeat that. Excuse me. There might be one here that would like to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. If you're already united to a church and you want to move your membership, we'll take it.
Amen.
We'll take it.
Amen.
We're not going to be selfish.
Amen.
And so forth. But anyway, it was ours to extend, yours to accept, or to reject. God bless you.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Sheila.
You heard the reading of the minutes. Are there any necessary corrections? If not, the minutes stand approved as read. God bless our, we're not even going to call him visitor anymore.
No, no.
And he keeps on coming. I think we might welcome him into the fold.
Yeah.
God bless you.
Amen.
We enjoy seeing you. Are there any announcements? Yeah, fifth Sunday board is this afternoon, and it will be at Friendly Will Baptist Church in South Austin. That address is 1001 Ditmar Road. However, our van is going today, and we'll meet at the church here at 2:15 for those that might want to ride the van. Let's go and support our pastor today. He's bringing the message today.
Amen.
So let's go and support him. Let's pray for the New Light Church as a whole. We got some members going through some things.
Yeah.
We're all going through some things.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we all need prayer.
We
so
all.
Let's keep New Light lifted up.
Yeah.
And be aware and be it known that we're not exempt from trouble.
No.
Because trouble is everywhere.
Yeah.
We're ready to go, God. God bless you for coming to your Sunday school. God bless our Sunday school. Help it to grow. Stand beside it and guide it, that the knowledge of God we might know. Bless the teachers, the superintendent, and the students that we teach. God bless our Sunday school. Bless souls we might reach. God bless our Sunday school. Bless souls we might reach. Let us hold fast.
Let us hold fast.
To the profession of our faith.
To the profession of our faith.
Without wavering.
Without wavering.
Because he is faithful.
Because he is faithful.
That promise.
That promise.
You are excused. God bless you.